totally honest.
Nor would I expect it. I just.
Hey!
Hello!
How are you doing?
Good!
I've heard this is going to take me a half hour. Could you knock out a half hour after this?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Because I have a Zoom meeting at 3. That's just hiring a development director. We've had two of those today. One was great, and then there was another one.
Oh, there was one.
That's right. One occurred,
nice.
And another one was just happening.
Yeah, I'm free now.
It used to be unsteady was the common. I used to get emails. Dear Dr. Unsteady.
It changed Randy once to Tandy. I was like, well, that's cute.
It's a throwback to Radio Shack computing.
We're going to work on musician punctuality today. All of our performers are here. But, you know, as musicians, we like to start 2 minutes late. So I'll be back in a couple of minutes. Just enjoy your
fellowship.
Theorists.
Yeah.
Well, like the concert usually starts at like 8:02.
Yeah. In South America. I mean, y'all know what I mean, you know, isn't that true?
Or Europe.
Yeah. Mm.
Yeah, Europe, where the scheduled start time is like 9 p.m. Like.
Yes.
When I'm doing an opera and it gets over after midnight.
Yeah.
When
we
and you're just like, come on, come on, finish.
I don't know, it's a purple sheet.
I know, I know.
Oh, so where did you find those? We all need them.
So Stephen Kuzukuma set up some sort of eBay alert for me. You know, like, got my shoe size, and then when one popped up, he poured me a link, and I
found one. Did you ask him to do that?
No. He had heard me complaining about my inability to secure a pair. Mm-hmm. You solved my problem.
Look at him now.
I get to wear them tomorrow, too. There's a development
event.
I'm on a panel, and we've been asked to wear Herman gear. I was like, well, let me tell you something.
You're going to be the talk of the town.
They get them bad athletics, coaches, and then they have like these long periods of time.
Yeah.
It's a weird.
Hello, everybody, and welcome. I'm Dr. Benjamin Dobbs. I'm assistant professor of music theory here at Furman. I also have the pleasure of being the coordinator of music theory and composition. On behalf of Dr. Dan Corris, our adjunct professor of composition, who can't be here today because he is jet-setting being a living, working composer, and the theory composition area, the music department, and Furman, welcome to this session of New Music by Furman Composers. One of the things that we truly love about Furman is the level, degree of collaboration that happens between our students and our faculty, but also, and perhaps more importantly, amongst and between our students as peers and colleagues and young professionals. In fact, before this session, I just came from a screening of a brand new short film that was written and directed and produced and recorded and cameraed and driven and all by Furman students. In fact, we had two Furman composers who wrote the score for that, Rowan Halloran and Xavier Johnson. And so that level of collaboration is something that is truly special at Furman, and we value that highly. Today, you're going to hear the results of collaboration between three fine young composers and their professors, but also between those composers and their peer performers. So we have Furman composers having their works played by Furman students, and it's going to be a special afternoon. So, we've got three compositions here today from, in reverse order, Michelle West, Miranda Hartnett, and Connor Gregory. These students have been working all semester and all year on some really fantastic, creative, collaborative projects, and I'm excited to hear their hard work pay off today. So I will introduce each composer, who will then briefly introduce themselves and their performers. I think of this more as a really wonderful salon rather than a formal recital. So everybody's going to come up into the audience, and it's a fantastic celebration of hard work and engaged learning here at Fermi. So that's enough of me. Let's hear from Michelle West, our first composer.
It's kind of inspired by some minimalist genres and compositions. The name itself, While I'm Thinking, was originally a placeholder name, just kind of have it there while I'm thinking of a better one. But I eventually adopted it, and it kind of, my ideas for the pieces grew from there. Today, I will be having some of my really good friends perform it for me. Julia Swim and Annabelle Buxbaum on violin, Leah Forrest on viola, and Anna Dar on cello. So,
thank you. introduce Cookies.
Hunter Mitten on French horn, Annabelle Kim
In addition to, this is the maybe the last year that I get to make the joke that Connor's recently formed by Adele. Connor is an Earth Environmental and Sustainability Sciences major, and he specializes in geology and those sorts of things. And he writes rock music.
Just took the words right out of my mouth. So we've got Amun Ra, which is for symphonic band. This is the first symphonic band piece I've written. It's inspired by ancient Egyptian mythology. So this one is about the god of the sun, Ra, and it follows the sunrise to the sunset. So it begins with kind of darkness before the sunrise, and then it kind of builds up to this metaphorical birth of Ra with the full sunrise, and there's the giant major chord and all that stuff. And then eventually, we get to midday, and the sun starts to set, and the piece is settling down, but then we have this exciting piece of mythology I found about Apophis, the great serpent, which tries to destroy the world every night, and Ra battles him when he leaves the world in the sunrise and the sunset. So towards the end, as it sounds like it's settling down, we get the serpent is taunting Ra to come fight him, save the world or whatever. So that's towards the end, and then the sunset follows that. So it returns to the same way it begins, the cyclic day pattern. I will add that the band is rehearsing this currently, on and off, but they don't fit on the stage, and the piece is not ready yet, so we're going to listen to the wonderful sounds of Note Performer.
Thank you.
discussion. So at this point, I'd like to invite our composers down to the front for a bit of Q&A from the audience, if y'all will join me on stage. So if I could, I'm going to start it and think of all the super hard questions for our students. So what have you learned this semester working on this project?
I guess I can go first. For me, it's taught me a lot more about how to write for strings. I am a string player, so that does make it a little bit easier when writing for the instrumentation that I play. But kind of figuring out what they're really, really good at, using the instrumentation to my advantage. Also notation, not specifically in this movement, but in other movements of this piece, I've kind of experimented with some different notation and effects and just figuring out how to better write. Dr. Boyce has helped me a lot kind of with finalizing my ideas and really getting them to a solid place so it's not just kind of shallow thought, but really thought out, prepared, and holistic and complete.
Along similar lines, I learned a lot about writing for really different instruments than what I was familiar with. Because I played the piano, I had just written for strings before, and I wanted to branch out even more, so I thought woodwinds is a good challenge. So I learned a ton about that from Dr. Forrest too, and notation in general. I think I know my way around the Sibelius finally, but it's been a long journey. another thing is, so finalizing my ideas too. That was a huge thing that I've been working on ongoing. And we focused specifically on development. And we are in another piece too, in our lessons. But in the seminar, I really worked to develop a main motif and just take that as far as I could and make a cohesive piece out of it.
So I had written a lot of orchestra pieces before this, so going to band was a bit challenging because I'm essentially removing an entire set of instruments that I really like to use, and that don't need to breathe, which is pretty useful. So now, and with band, there's a bit of more pressure on the percussion section, because in orchestra, a lot of times you'll have timpani, maybe cymbals, maybe like a couple other things, but band, there's always lots of percussion instruments, and I still didn't quite tackle the percussion section, but I was figuring out how to start writing a bit more for them and how to deal with the different dynamic of a really large woodwind section and a bit of a larger brass section with the strings, and then also pacing the ideas that I had for the different melodies and everything, because this was also first time I've done a major piece following a more specific outline or idea behind it. Commonly, I'll just have a loose idea. Like I had, some of you know about, I had the orchestra Oceans pieces, which each of those was just based on an ocean, but it was kind of just a vague, like the Atlantic Ocean. This one is stormy sounding, but that was pretty much the only thought that went into it before I started, and I just kind of went with it. And then this time it was like, well, I need to have the beginning sound like this, and in the middle is going to be something, and then the snake. So there's some different things going on.
I think you hit on one of the biggest dangers in writing for band, is that there are often 10 or 11 percussionists, and if you don't keep them busy, they will miss the paper.
I definitely did not keep 11 percussionists busy, but you know, the troublesomeness will decline in the future.
Questions for our composers? Dr. Helling.
So I'm Dr. Helling. I'm the writing program instructor. So FYW and WR, those fun classes. So I'm struck by hearing you talk about writing, composing music. And I'm wondering if you could talk for a few minutes about similarities and differences in writing for music and writing with words.
I can kind of start that, I guess. I feel like usually when I start writing essays or I have like creative works that I want to write with words, I usually have a pretty good idea of where I want to go. I might start at the beginning, I might start in the middle. I feel I kind of start wherever is my strongest point. I feel like that's fairly similar with how I write music. This piece, especially this year, I was all over the place. I thought it was going to be one longer piece, and then it split up into three different movements. But I always have these kind of ideas that just come to me that I really want to build off of, that type of thing. That can be like based off of emotions or ideas or storylines, that type of thing. But I usually kind of start somewhere and then branch off. I feel like I do that kind of similarly with writing.
I feel like my writing and composition styles are similar in the same way, kind of, where I tend to structure something out with an outline first, come up with maybe an architecture for it, and then tackle my strongest points first, or like go with what my first idea is leading to. And then go in with more specific places that I can fill in from there. But yeah, usually I come up with a theme first, and if I'm writing an essay or something, maybe a thesis can replace that. But yeah, it could be a beginning, end, or I could start from the middle in a composition, whereas I tend to write more linearly, unless it's just a bullet point for a paper or something. But yeah, in composition, I tend to try not to piece it together as much anymore, but I did have a tendency to do that more. Now to try to make it flow more, I do focus in more on the building blocks between each section.
I would say the ways that you think about the pacing and the tone of your writing is pretty much exactly the same in composing. You're just working with music as the medium instead of prose. But you still think of how do I connect these sentences together? How do I connect these melodies together? Because sometimes the melodies are kind of like sentences, and in fact we literally use the term sentence to describe musical lines sometimes. So I would say there's a lot of similarities in how you're approaching the work as a whole. What kind of tone do I want this passage to have? And instead of what words do I use to do that, you say what chords do I use, or what instrument combinations do I use, and things like that.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Okay. As you're writing, what is the strangest or most unique source of inspiration that you draw from?
Yes.
I have notes for this, actually. In this piece, I happened to hear something a while ago that just stuck with me, and I found myself like dwelling on this album called La Strada Invisibile by this Italian duo of a pianist and an accordionist. I think that's right. Accordion player. Yes. And they were influenced by similar things that I'm usually inspired by, like a combination of jazz and classical music, and for them, art songs. But I didn't expect it to stick with me because I had no idea who they were until I heard them just in passing. And I found out, or I did some research to find them again, and I figured out where that source came from. But yeah, that was an interesting, unexpected source of inspiration for me. Because I usually am more conscious about what I'm taking from, or what I gravitate to. I'm aware of it as I go, but that just struck me. I remember it.
I can go now. I find myself getting inspired by a lot of things that just kind of surround me. So when I watched Oppenheimer last summer, I fell in love with the soundtrack. I absolutely love Ludwig Göransson, and I love Christopher Nolan. So movie music, I feel like, kind of inspires me. I don't know if that's necessarily strange, but that's something that I drew a lot of inspiration off of. Also, kind of sticking with like the surrounding theme, just this first year since I am a freshman, just kind of taking my experiences. I feel like in the past my compositions have been a little bit more forefront focused, and this one is a little bit more kind of like my background thoughts, kind of like, oh, I'm always busy, like what am I always thinking of, that type of thing. So kind of what's in the back of my head while I'm thinking, like that.
Howard Shore and John Williams, they're the big ones. Also Mahler. It's like sometimes I'll just try to listen to some random piece that maybe I know about it, I haven't heard it before or whatever, and just kind of, I'll just hear one part and be like, oh, that's kind of an idea of a sound or something, and then I'll just kind of have it in my head. The main thing I try to, I guess it's kind of connected to the question, the main thing I try to do when I don't really have a lot of ideas is I kind of turn to the harmonics and the chords kind of and try to break free of typical patterns like that are common in your theory class or something. No. instead of like trying to default to that, see if you can do something else. And then you'll be like, oh, that's really cool. And I'll just add this little clarinet rhythm on the top of it or something. And then you just go from there.
What's your favorite instrument to write for? Kelsey says, holding her flute.
I can start. I'm a little biased. I love cello. I play cello. I feel like I know it the best. Even though I did give this piece a little bit more of a boring line because of what type of genre I was trying to write for, I feel like I really like playing. I love playing cello. I really like writing cello lines. I feel like I know what I want, and it's really easy to find sounds. But I also really love piano. I can just sit down, and that's usually where I start is a piano. I just sit down, and I mess around, and I improv until I find something that I really enjoy. So kind of moving piano lines to other lines, like strings, that kind of thing, that's usually what I like.
I'd say my favorite instrument to write for is also piano. But besides that, I love a new opportunity of writing for another instrument, being able to write for musicians to play it too. So I'd say so far my favorite has been woodwinds in terms of any other instrument. Although I have limited experience in that at this point. But yeah, I really enjoyed that process. And it's similar for me too. I tend to improvise things on the piano first, unless I have an idea that I write down and then work with it. But yes, a lot of improvisation and tying up my part too. So I think that's why I tend to write, it's easier for me to write your piano to begin with. But yeah, taking that away from the piano and adapting it for other instruments is something I've been working on, and beyond that, writing for other instruments, getting out of the piano headspace as much.
I really don't think you can go wrong with a really loud and low trombone. I don't think anything reaches that level of just menacing, impending doom, you know? Or so.
Other questions?
So you talked a little bit about melody lines, the situation goes together. I've noticed in all of your pieces a lot of the rhythm, I guess, affected me as much as anything else. And in each one of yours, the Amun-Ra, the rhythms really did sound like you listened to music from that region of the world, things like that. And I was curious, yours, a waltz rhythm, but there was one point where it seemed to switch. And you said something about jazz. Maybe it was an intentional change rhythm. And I'm an amateur musician, so I got it the right word to use? Or
yes.
Rhythm? Okay, so if you could kind of talk about how you thought about rhythm, that would be interesting.
Yeah, so there's this middle section in my piece where it switches to a kind of hippie-ola feel where it's, not exactly, but it's felt more in tune, but the overall piece is obviously in 3/4. So I experimented with dotted rhythms a lot. I've been doing that more. And I think it has been influenced by jazz, because I listen to and play mostly that. So I try not to let it take over everything, but yeah, definitely working it where I can and make it flow. And I thought that was a nice pause in the middle of the piece, or like a fresh breath from the one to the
For my movement, I definitely was going for the legato kind of connected route. For each of the movements, I do have a little bit more rhythmic experimentation in other movements. You should come. There's a quartet concert next Wednesday at 7:30, where they will be performing my third movement, and then we have our jury and recital on April 22nd at 26 at 2:30, so you can hear other ones. But for this movement, I really wanted to go for kind of like the painstakingly like slow, like tug at your heartstrings, but still have these small changes over time, kind of going with the whole minimalist genre. When I first had drafts and I brought it to Dr. Forrest, he was like, this is too slow. It's so stagnant. People are going to get so bored. And I was like, yeah, that's probably true. So I tried to find like ways to add rhythm to still kind of like push along the lines. To give it some movement, but not enough where I feel like I'm like running for my life or anything.
I haven't specifically thought about this much before, but I actually think that rhythm is more important than pitch or what the melody is, because you can take like one arpeggio pattern and manipulate it an infinite number of ways with the rhythm, but if you take one rhythm, like if you just have a bunch of quarter notes over and over again and you keep changing the pitch, I think that's going to sound boring after a while, even if the notes are never the same because the rhythm is just stagnant. So I think thinking of the rhythm is more of the, well, I don't know. I mean, I guess it's more of the chord sometimes, but it's also how you keep things varied.
I'd like to ask two questions, and then you're out of options. All right, so first, what's next for you? Do you have another project in mind, or a skill or a technique that you'd like to explore or develop next? How do you intend to keep growing as a composer? Connor, you look really excited.
I do have a project. I have written a song cycle for Preludes by T.S. Eliot, which is a set of four. I think some people listen about that because Gail was singing it for a while. But set of four short poems, and that piece was soprano and piano just together. And I really enjoyed writing that, so I'm turning to a slightly longer and slightly more complex work by T.S. Eliot called The Wasteland, which, yeah. I have been meeting with Dr. Riedel, analyzing and everything, but that's going to be for a string quartet and piano with a few different singers. And if I can plug this to the vocal department, I was trying to see if they would be willing to play it next year at some point. But I'm working on it now, and it's been very very fun to work on. It's a lot of different sounds than I've written before and different approaches. And it's fun to work with text like that because you kind of know what you're going to have to do. You can't really get stuck unless you don't really know how to approach a certain passage. But you always know what the next passage is going to be. And it kind of forces you into certain things that way and certain sounds because you want to be true to the text. So that's a really
The next thing I've been working towards, I've been thinking about writing for percussion for a while, but one thing at a time. So I started with piano, then strings. I have experimented more with the violins recently, and I think the next step is percussion for me. Because I play a little bit, but besides that, it's not really the point. There's so much that I didn't consider at first in the range of percussion, like all the different instruments beyond just the film set. And that's just the limitation that I had for a while, realizing that I can write pitched music for percussion. So I'm excited to do that, delve into it. And I haven't written for any text before. So I think that is something I've also been thinking about, but more in terms of instrumentation. Definitely percussion soon. morphed more into a rondo.
Just wait until class next week. We'll talk about sonata rondos.
Oh, boy.
So that's the sign of my favorite. For the past semester as well. But yeah, I'm focusing more and more on that. So I'll see where that takes me.
For me, I've only ever really written for strings, piano, and voice, and marimba singular. So for me, I really like writing for people that I know and writing for like instruments that I'm just like people that I know. Mostly when I was writing the string quartet, I was thinking of my friends in particular. So I would really like to expand more into the wind section. We had a concert here a few weeks ago that had like flute ensemble, clarinet choir, and it was a lot of timbres and sounds that I never really experienced before, so I think taking advantage of some of that. I also, similar to Miranda, I've been wanting to write for percussion for a while. I've had like this percussion quartet like in the back of my head for 2 years, and I just like, never like followed through with it, so I definitely want to experiment with that a little more. I also want to look more at like specific forms and stuff. Usually I just kind of write and whatever comes out, but kind of sticking to some more structured ideas, that type of thing. And also just some more experimentation with like a tonal or interesting woodwind effects, that type of thing. That's something that I'm looking for.
So to wrap up, being a composer is hard work, right? And it's hard to sit there by yourself with you and Sibelius, or you and your piano, or you and your pen. It can be a little lonely and challenging just to get all those great ideas from here to here to here. It's such hard work. So reflecting back on your semester and all of your hard work, what's one thing that brought you joy about this project?
Start with that. Yeah, it was a pretty busy semester. Adding comp onto everything else kind of was a lot. I tend to set unrealistic expectations for myself and then try and fulfill them. It's like, ooh, that's a little hard. But for me, writing is very hard to get things out and get them to come out in the right way and to get that process started. Once I'm going, I feel good. But the biggest thing for me is just seeing the final product performance today, getting to work with them in coachings. That's what's really special to me, to share it with people. It's definitely a little vulnerable to have a whole audience listen to something that I wrote in my bedroom at like midnight, but it's really special just kind of seeing it in process.
I think the hardest part
for
me, that still brought me joy is, that's part of it, but first, it's just starting a piece at all. But once I get past that, I really enjoy the rest of the process. So last semester in comp cinema, we talked about mainly melody, that was the whole topic. And with that, it was mainly thinking more horizontally instead of vertical with like, the instrumentation and texture and harmony and harmonies as much. So I was really zoned into, from that especially, just trying to think about what comes next in terms of each individual note. And sometimes it's great when I have a melody just hit me, or it's been in the back of my head and I finally realize it. But when I'm just grinding away and trying to work out material and come up with cohesive content, yeah, it's the most enjoyable when it comes together just from inspiration. But besides that, yeah, I still enjoy finding the next note. It's exciting when, because I know when I found it, or like, you know when it sounds good, and you can move on from that, maybe efficiently. But yeah, I tend to go out of that a lot and revise things as you do. But yeah, it feels good when you can move on to the next thing, and you feel like you have something that you want to say.
What are you enjoying?
Well, aside from getting an excuse to write for really well and rest, I always find a way, but the most fun part of the video project for me, regardless of how the beginning goes, because I've had a lot of pieces where I start writing it and I'm like, this is just not that great until I finish. figure something out, and I'm like, oh, now the beginning works, or something like that. Or if it starts off, oh, this is really fun already. No matter how the beginning goes, the most fun part always ends up being like around the middle or towards the end, where I have some idea that I never thought was gonna be in there, and it just kind of adds some color to it. It's always like something that kind of changes it up or adds something that I wasn't expecting to be there, and it works out really nicely. That's always the best part.
So as we're wrapping up, Michelle alluded to our music composition jury recital, which takes place on Friday, April 26th at 2:30. My schedule,
I think so.
Yeah, I think it's 2:30-ish. Check the calendar. And we'll hear more compositions from these folks, as well as from a few others, and you're all welcome to that public performance before they go and sit their private panel with the faculty. Yes. But so that'll be a wonderful celebration of all of their hard work. And before we thank them, so I'd like to say a special thank you to Connor. So Connor is, assuming that things go well, going to graduate this year. And even though he's not a music composition major, he's been one of our most dedicated and most curious and most hardworking composers, and we're really going to miss him. So congratulations, probably, Connor.
Yeah, it's a very tragic story.
It is.